Hello, Vital Sign. Today we're going to explore three important properties of the lexicographic product of graphs. If you haven't already, I suggest you watch my previous video on the lexicographic product of graphs, as it will give you the background information applied in this video. The first property we're going to look at is the right-distributive law of the lexicographic product. The lexicographic product right-distributes over disjoint union, which is represented with a plus symbol in graph theory. Here are some examples of disjoint unions of graphs. Essentially, from a disjoint union of two graphs, we just get a graph comprised of a copy of each graph we applied the disjoint union to, with no vertices linking to vertices outside their copy. Now that we cover disjoint unions, let's dig into what this right distributive law means. It says, take two graphs G and H and take their disjoint union, G plus H. Then take the lexicographic product of this graph, G plus H, with some other graph, F, with F being the second or right graph in the product. Then the result will be equivalent to the disjoint union of the lexicographic product of G with F and the lexicographic product of H with F. This looks like the familiar property of multiplication distributing over addition. Let me show you an example now. Let's take the disjoint union of this graph, G, with this graph, H. And then let's take the lexicographic product of that graph with this graph, F. Feel free to pause and do this yourself. I've left a little recap in the bottom left-hand corner of the adjacency conditions for a lexicographic product. Remember that the vertex set of the lexicographic product is the Cartesian product of the vertex sets of the factor graphs. Here's our final result. Now if we then take the lexicographic product of G with F, and then the lexicographic product of H with F, and then take the disjoint union of those two graphs, what we get is the same graph as the lexicographic product of G plus H with F. They are indeed equivalent. You can think about it this way. The lexicographic product tells us, using the second adjacency condition, copy the right graph for each vertex in the left graph. For pairs of copies with left entries adjacent in the left graph, connect every vertex in one copy to every vertex in the other copy. Note that vertices with different left entries in the lexicographic product can only be connected if their left entries are adjacent vertices in the left graph, and this comes from the first adjacency condition. There is no other way for two vertices in a lexicographic product with different left entries to be adjacent, as the second adjacency condition deals only with vertices with the same left entry. So, if your left graph happens to have two components disconnected from each other, as is the case for graphs G plus H that are the union of two connected graphs G and H, then pairs of vertices in the lexicographic product with left entries in different components cannot be adjacent. In other words, the lexicographic product of the disjoint union of G and H produces two connected components. Within each connected component, we have copies of graph F, the right graph, and the copies are linked to each other according to the first adjacency condition, just as they would be in a typical lexicographic product of just G and F or just H and F. The two connected components are precisely the lexicographic product of G with F and the lexicographic product of H with F. This is the exact same thing as a graph that is the disjoint union of the lexicographic products of G with F and of H with F. Therefore, they are equivalent. I hope this clarifies why the lexicographic product right distributes over disjoint union. Now you might be wondering, what if we have something like this, where the disjoint union graph is the right graph of our lexicographic product? Does it still distribute? The answer is no. A counterexample is enough to show that this is not true. First, here is the lexicographic product of F with G plus H. Notice how it is a single connected component. In other words, a connected graph. Therefore, it cannot be the same as the disjoint union of the lexicographic products of F with G and F with H, as by definition, a disjoint union of two connected graphs is a graph with two components, not one component. In general, the disjoint union of the lexicographic products of G with F and H with F is guaranteed to be a graph with at least two connected components. However, when the disjoint union graph is the right graph in a lexicographic product, which is the one that is copied and then linked according to the adjacencies of the left graph, then that lexicographic product is not necessarily split into at least two connected components. It could be the case that it is a graph with only one connected component, as in this case. So lexicographic products right distribute over disjoint union, but they do not left distribute over disjoint union. The second property we're going to look at is an identity related to complementation and the lexicographic product. The complement of the lexicographic product of two graphs, G and H, is the lexicographic product of the complement of G with the complement of H. Why? Well, remember what the complement of a graph does. The complement of a graph is an operation that connects all pairs of vertices non-adjacent to each other in the original graph and disconnects all adjacent pairs of vertices in the original graph. Take a look at what happens when we take the complement of the lexicographic product of these two graphs, G and H. First, just take their lexicographic product. Next, here's the complement of their lexicographic product. Notice that the pair of vertices that were not adjacent became adjacent, and the pairs of vertices that were adjacent became not adjacent. Because only the pairs of vertices in a graph that are not adjacent are adjacent in the complement of that graph, we need to ask ourselves what pairs of vertices in the lexicographic product are not adjacent to each other in order to find out what pairs of vertices in the complement of the lexicographic product are adjacent to each other. Keeping in mind the adjacency conditions for the lexicographic product of two graphs, that would be all pairs where the left entries are different and not adjacent vertices, or where the left entries are the same and the right entries are different and not adjacent vertices. These are our new adjacency conditions for the complement of a lexicographic product of G and H. Note that we have to include this and part here, because if we just said U not adjacent to U prime, that would include every pair of vertices where U equals U prime, as vertices are not adjacent to themselves. And our original graph had some adjacencies between vertices where U equals U prime, according to the second adjacency condition in red. So unless we include that and part, we would be including edges from our original graph, meaning it wouldn't be a complement. So to make sure we don't miss anything, two vertices in the lexicographic product are not adjacent if their left entries are not adjacent and are different vertices, as then there would be no way for them to be adjacent in a lexicographic product, or if their left entries are the same vertex and their right entries are not adjacent. Now that we have these adjacency conditions for the complement of a lexicographic product, let's head back to our complementation identity. To show the equivalence between the complement of the lexicographic product and the lexicographic product of the complements, all we need to do is determine the adjacency conditions of the lexicographic product of the complements. By the first adjacency condition, two vertices in the lexicographic product of the complement of G with the complement of H are adjacent if their left entries are adjacent vertices, which actually implies they are different vertices as well in the complement of G. Since only non-adjacent pairs of vertices in G are connected in the complement of G, then the top statement translates to the one below, meaning left entries that are not adjacent yet are different vertices in graph G. By the second adjacency condition, two vertices in the lexicographic product of the complement of G with the complement of H are adjacent if their left entries are the same vertex in the complement of G, and if their right entries are adjacent in the complement of H. The statement translates to if their left entries are the same in G, and their right entries are not adjacent in H. These are precisely the same adjacency conditions as those for the complement of the lexicographic product of G and H. So they are equivalent. The final property we're going to look at is the clique number of a lexicographic product. The clique number of a graph, represented by omega of G, is the size of the largest clique in that graph. The clique number of the lexicographic product of two graphs, G and H, is the product of the clique numbers of G and of H. To see why, we can start by constructing a large clique in the lexicographic product of G and H. First, remember that in a lexicographic product, we copy the right graph once for each vertex of graph G, and then for every pair of copies with left entries adjacent in graph G, we connect each vertex in one copy to every vertex in the other copy. So, suppose we fix U, our left entry, to be some vertex in the left graph, say A in this case, and then vary V, our right entry, over all vertices in the maximum clique of graph H, which is 1, 2, 3 in this case, a 3 clique. Then connect all of these vertices, as two vertices are connected if their left entries are equal and their right entries are adjacent in H. And this is the case for all of these vertices, because all of their right entries come from the same clique in H. What we obtain is a copy of the maximum clique of graph H in the lexicographic product. Now, repeat this process for every vertex in the maximum clique in G. That is, generate a copy of the maximum clique in H for every vertex in the maximum clique in G. Notice that every vertex in each of these copies connects to every vertex in the other copies by the first adjacency condition, as their left entries are in the same maximum clique in graph G. Wow, that's a lot of edges. Now, what we just built was the maximum clique in the lexicographic product of G and H, with a size equal to the product of the sizes of the maximum cliques in G and in H. In general, this is the process of constructing the maximum clique in the lexicographic product of any two graphs, G and H. First, find a maximum clique in H, and then find a maximum clique in G. Next, copy the maximum clique in H for each vertex in the maximum clique in G. Each copy of the maximum clique in H remains a clique in the lexicographic product due to the second adjacency condition. And the different copies all mutually connect to each other by the first adjacency condition, giving us a clique in the lexicographic product equal in size to the product of the maximum cliques in G and in H. Why can this resulting clique be no larger? Well, assume there was another vertex, UV, in the lexicographic product that we could add to the set of vertices to make it larger and still a clique. That is, UV is some other vertex that is adjacent to every other vertex in our current collection. Then by the adjacency conditions of a lexicographic product, either U must be unique and adjacent to the left entry of all the other vertices in our current collection, or U equals some left entry we've already seen in our collection, and V is unique and adjacent to all the other right entries we've seen in our collection. Regardless, this produces a contradiction, as that would mean we could add a vertex to either the maximum clique in G or an H and obtain a larger clique. Yet by definition of maximum clique, there can be no larger clique. Therefore, our construction has produced the largest possible clique in the lexicographic product of G and H. I'd like to leave you with two exercises. Can you, using a similar argument to the one we just used to prove our clique number identity, prove that the independence number, that is, the size of the largest independent set of the lexicographic product of G and H, is the product of the independence numbers of G and H? Also, can you write a closed form expression for the number of edges in the lexicographic product of G and H using the number of vertices and edges in G and in H? Let me know how it goes in the comments. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe, like, share, and comment if you liked the video. Have a great day.